Welcome back, students. We were at IUCD and we have just seen the contraindications for intrauterine copper device. The list is big, but I would like you to remember certain causes like patient having irregular or heavy bleeding, copper is not advised. Patient having PID, contraindicated. Then in patient with either some kind of uterine anomaly, or heart disease patient because it increases the chances of endocarditis, and in nulliparous and unmarried women. Advantages: once it is inserted, it gives continuous protection for long time, depending on the age of the property, 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, depending on it. It's very highly effective. The newer IUCDs are as effective as oral contraceptive pills. Previously, the first 1 year, the failure rate is almost 3%, but as the use goes on increasing, then 1% at the end of 5 years. There is no user failure, means user cannot make any mistake so that the contraceptive can fail. There is no evidence of reduced fertility following its removal. About 75% women conceive within 6 months of its removal, and almost 90% conceive within a year. There are no systemic ill effects like or unlike oral contraceptive pills. Oral contraceptives have systemic side effects in many forms, from weight gain to leading to thromboembolic phenomena. This way, copper doesn't have any systemic ill effects. No adverse effects on lactation is observed, so it is preferred in lactational period as well. Copper is inserted free of cost in government hospitals in India. Most IUCDs have an average lifespan of 3 years. Let's see, according to the type of the copper T, what's their lifespan. Multinode 375, which is commonly used, it has a lifespan of 5 years. Again, this table I have made especially for you to remember the different lifespan of different copper Ts. It is very important, MCQ can be asked on anything. Multinode is commonly used, the lifespan is 5 years. Copper T 380A. 10 years. This MCQ has already been asked. Progestacert, the life is 1 year. Copper T200B has 4 years in US and 3 years whatever is manufactured in India. And the progesterone containing IUCD, they have life of 7 to 10 years, but they are approved for 5 years. Now, before going to other method, let's just revise the period or timings when we can insert the copper T. Copper T can be inserted interval period, that means post menstrually. We can call the patient once she is post menstrual, that means we rule out that she is not pregnant. Then whenever the bleeding decreases during menstrual cycle, maybe on third day or fourth day, it is easy because the os is a little open. Copper T can be inserted post abortal, that we do MTP. That's the best time when the patient is very much receptive for the use of contraception. We can do opportunistic counseling and copper T can be inserted. Copper T can also be inserted immediately after delivery, but because the os is open, the uterus is of big size, there is increased failure rate in the form of expulsion of copper T. But nowadays many studies are going on and in which they are using copper T immediately after delivery or before the patient gets discharged from the ward after delivery. Even during cesarean section, it was thought that the expulsion rate is very high, but the studies are going on and it is inserted immediately during cesarean section. And people are finding that the failure rate is not that bad, or the expulsion rate, not the failure rate, the expulsion rate is not that bad. Patient is receptive and we can use that period when she is with us to use this method of contraception. The method or the technique used for insertion of copper T is called as withdrawal technique. This is used to avoid perforation. We withdraw the inserter above the plunger and the copper T gets released. So remember this name, withdrawal technique. Other copper Ts like multi-load, they have push technique. Even Mirena, it is a little thicker to insert. So sometimes we may have to dilate the cervical os when we insert the Mirena or progesterone containing copper T, because they are not that slender as a traditional copper T. So these are a few practical points for copper T insertion. Lost copper T diagnostic test can be asked. whenever the patient feels that she is not feeling the thread, we, after insertion of copper tip, we advise the patient that please keep feeling the thread, because that's the test that the copper tip is in situ. If the thread is missing, she might have either expelled it out during menstrual cycle or otherwise, or it may get dislodged in the cavity or outside the uterine cavity. And that is why once she doesn't feel the thread, she is supposed to come back. Or we call her for first follow-up after the first menses and ask her to get this follow-up done at least once in a year. On perspeculum examination, we see the copper tip thread. If it is not seen, we try to palpate the copper tip with the help of artery forceps or some metallic instrument. If we are not finding it in the cervical region, then maybe it is lost IUCD. We can go for an X-ray. X-ray tells us where the location of the copper tip is. More than that, the better investigation is USG. USG tells us about if it is buried inside the myometrium or not. X-ray can be improved by having sound in situ. Like we put uterine sound inside the uterine cavity and then take the X-ray, and that sound and its position in relation with the copper tip gives us much more information where the copper tip is, whether it is buried, whether it is in the cavity, going outside. Sound in situ X-ray is again an investigation of choice. Ultrasound is quite specific. So this is how we manage to remove the copper tip. We can have copper tip hook, or dilatation and curettage can be done to take out this lost copper tip. And sometimes if it has caused perforation gone inside, then we may need laparotomy for removal of the copper tip. So this was all about copper tip, and we have almost covered all the MCQs related with copper tip. Centchromin, it's another type of contraceptive. In India, it is called as Saheli. It is synthetic, non-steroidal contraceptive. It prevents implantation through endometrial changes. It's basically a strong anti-estrogenic and a weak estrogenic action it has peripherally at the receptor level. It is non-teratogenic or carcinogenic, and it exerts no pharmacological effect on other organs. Side effects: headache, nausea, vomiting, gain in weight. It does not protect against HIV and STD. Contraindications: it cannot be used 6 months of lactation, PCOD, hepatic dysfunctions, cervical dysplasias, allergy to the drug, or other few. There are some delay in return of fertility, that is of 6 months if this is used. Now, post-coital contraception, it's also called as emergency contraception. This is not basically contraception because this doesn't avoid contact of sperms and ovum, but this is a interceptive, because we are using it when unprotected coitus has taken place. We are using it just to avoid implantation. So it is called as, instead of contraceptive, it is more of interceptive. It's used as an emergency to prevent pregnancy after an unprotected intercourse. It combines delay of ovulation with a local effect on endometrium and prevention of fertilization. So it has combined effect. The indications are unprotected sex, or maybe sometimes condom rupture, that is a contraception failure, or missed pill. If the patient is on oral contraceptive pills and she misses the pills for maybe 2 or more days, then the pack doesn't give her complete protection. In that case, she is supposed to either use some other contraceptive or postcoital contraception. Missed period as a contraception failure, or in case of sexual assault or rape. Emergency contraception must be initiated within 72 hours of unprotected coitus. If the MCQ is put this way, that best action, then it is within 12 hours. Requirement is it should be used within 72 hours, but it is more effective if initiated within 12 hours. Please remember that it is not used as an abort efficient. If there is pregnancy, then this doesn't act. It acts before implantation takes place. So this has to be made very clear to the patient, and it should be very clear to you also, that it is ineffective in case of an established pregnancy. And if pregnancy is there, if implantation has already occurred, then it is of no use. There are many methods of emergency contraception. This chart will concisely help you to remember all of them. OC pills, USP regime, if two tablets of Overall followed by other two 12 hours later are used, they provide protection. So it's a method, USP regime, where Overall two tablets, stat dose, and two after 12 hours. High doses of estrogen, 0.5 mg of ethyl estradiol daily for 5 days starting within 72 hours of exposure. Levonorgestrel alone, most appropriate drug, or progesterone for emergency contraception. This is also called as eye pill, advertised on TV freely. 0.75 mg is taken within 72 hours, followed by another dose after 12 hours. Two tablets to be initiated again within 72 hours, and two tablets, two doses, 12 hours difference in that. There are many people who are coming with many either menorrhagia or intermenstrual bleeding or heavy bleeding because they are using this contraceptive without having proper knowledge of this. So it should not be used more than once in a month. These are very high doses of progesterone, so it will have side effects. That is why all these things should be counseled to the patient properly before using the contraceptive. Again, copper T, that is the copper intrauterine device, can also be used as emergency contraception. Copper T inserted within 5 to 7 days of unprotected coitus can act as an emergency contraception. Other famous drug, that is mifepristone or RU486, if a single dose of 10 mg given within 5 days, it is effective against causing pregnancy in 95% cases. Danazol also can be used, but as you have seen the list, the other drugs are more effective and with less side effects. So danazol really doesn't practically in use as a intraceptive or emergency contraception. Oral contraceptive pills, major chunk, very commonly used, popular method, most effective method of reversible method of contraception. I'm saying most effective. It combined because it has ethinyl estradiol plus either levonorgestrel or norethisterone or now the newer generation progesterone, that is desogestrel. Gradually over a period of time, the hormonal content of ethinyl estradiol, it has gone down. It is very less now. And even the progesterone which are coming up like desogestrel, they are having very less side effects. So the pills are just getting better and better with the time. Combined oral contraceptive pills are contraindicated in lactation because it adversely affects the milk secretion and there is also risk of thromboembolism. I'm stressing on this point. This is most effective contraception but not used in lactation. It decreases lactation as well as causes thromboembolic. Usually you remember about lactation but thromboembolic evidence you forget. So if there are two options, please take both of them in certain exams. Triphasic COC, that is combined oral contraceptive pills. The pills are in such combination that almost the physiological dose of hormone is released in body in first 7 days, in mid 7 days and last 7 days as per the requirement. First 7 days the estrogen is little more, progesterone is less. Mid, the variation, the estrogen dose is little lesser and progesterone. And in later, progesterone is higher than estrogen. So almost it mimics the physiological hormonal doses, thus causing very effective action as well as reducing the side effects. Progesterone only pills, that is POP, also called as mini pills. They contain only progesterone. And most indicated condition for POP is lactation, where COC, that is combined oral contraceptive pills, are not used or contraindicated. POP can be used in cases of hypertension. COC, no. POP can be used. In fibroids, diabetes, again COC, no. POP can be used. Patient with smoking, epilepsy, and in patient with thromboembolism, POP can be used. They also reduce the risk of CA endometrium. Overall failure rate is 0.5 to 2 per 100 women years. Now, about the mechanism. Many mechanisms, many questions. OCPs act. The MCQ can just go that they prevent ovulation, prevent fertilization, interfere with implantation, all of above, none of above can be there. So let's understand how OCPILs work. Prevention of ovulation. Progestin reduces frequency of LH secretory pulse, while estrogen primarily reduces the FSH secretion. So both they synergetically act and inhibit the mid-cycle surge. Thus, as a result, the follicle fails to develop and there is no rupture that leads to no ovulation. Again, prevention of fertilization by there is formation of thick cervical mucus plug, which is hostile to sperms, and thus it inhibit fertilization. Again, it also affects uterine and tubal contractions. They are modified to disfavor the fertilization. So fertilization doesn't take place. For on implantation, because of the actions of estrogen and progesterone, the endometrium is either hyperproliferative or hypersecretory or atrophic. In short, they are out of phase with fertilization and not suitable for nidation. So implantation doesn't take place. Even if ovulation and fertilization occur, implantation does not occur normally. So it acts at all three levels. It prevents ovulation, fertilization, and also implantation. What are the non-contraceptive benefits of OCPILs? Again, many questions on OCPILs, related cancers, risk, non-contraceptive uses. Let's divide it into two, that benefits related with the genital tract and benefits unrelated to the genital tract. OCPIL is protective against uterine cancer, fibroid uterus, progesterone only pills, ovarian cancers, ovarian cysts. They are used as treatment 3 to 6 cycles in functional ovarian cysts. They will just give rest to the ovary and the cyst will disappear. Even in endometriosis, they can be used. Then PID, salpingitis specifically, ectopic pregnancy, as it decreases incidence of PID. It decreases ovulation, so helpful in dysmenorrhea, premenstrual tension, and Mittelschmerz syndrome. By decrease in blood loss, they also helpful in menorrhagia and polymenorrhea. So in all these clinical conditions, we can use OCPILs. Unrelated to genital tract, they can be used in acne, hirsutism, where we have OCPILs containing cipriterone acetate. They can be used in PCO patient and can take care of all the factors like menstrual cycles would be regular. Then there would be effect on hirsutism because cipriterone acetate is added to that, and even acne. Autoimmune disorders of thyroid, colorectal cancers, osteopenia, osteoporosis, benign breast neoplasms, and rheumatoid arthritis and anemia. Remember, ovarian cancers, ovarian cysts, PID, endometriosis. So these are some common uses of OCPILs. They are also beneficial in DUB, hormone therapy for hypothalamic amenorrhea. OCPILs are used where hypothalamus is, there is some problem, and because of that there is not much of secretion of GnRH that leads to decreased secretion of FSH and LH, and there is deficiency of estrogen. So in that case, exogenous source OCPILs can be used. Prevention of menstrual porphyria. OCPILs are protective against benign breast diseases, but as far as carcinoma breast is concerned, the role is controversial. But benign fibroadenosis and all those conditions, we can use OCPILs. OCPILs are being considered in the etiology of CA breast. So the role is variable. We are not very sure about the role. Side effects, non-serious and serious types. Non-serious are like nausea, vomiting, headache, migraine may get precipitated. There can be breakthrough bleeding or spotting, or there can be even amenorrhea for a while after the use of OCPILs because the endometrium really becomes atrophic. Breast discomfort or mastalgia. Serious side effects are like pulmonary thrombosis or leg vein thrombosis. There can be coronary artery or cerebral artery thrombosis, hypertension, increased chances of myocardial infarction and stroke, cholecystic jaundice, and gallbladder stone. You have to remember all these side effects. Some side effects, they may appear little later. They are like weight gain, acne, increased body hair, cloisma or pruritus vulva, carbohydrate intolerance, mood swing, abdominal distension, monilial vaginitis or corneal edema and irritation. So these may be few side effects of OCPL. Cancer related to OCPL use: carcinoma cervix, hepatic adenoma, pituitary adenoma, breast cancer. But the action or the effect of OCPL on pituitary adenoma, we are not very sure. It may be there, may not be there. And breast cancer, as I've already told you, I'm not sure. But CA cervix, the risk factor as OCPL is considered, and even in hepatic adenoma. So in liver disorders, OCPL are contraindicated. What are the contraindications for OCPL? There are absolute. If there is known or suspected breast cancer, or even if there is family history, as the role is not well defined, please don't give OCPL to such patient. Severe hypertriglyceridemia or hypercholesteremia, in those patients, OCPL are not to be given. Vaginal bleeding, irregular, the cause is not yet defined. Then smokers over the age of 35 years, thrombophlebitis, thromboembolic disorders, we are not supposed to give. Pregnancy, absolute contraindication. Even in hypertension, if it is moderate to severe, OCPL are not to be prescribed, they will precipitate. And impaired liver function and infective hepatitis. As we said already, that liver disorders, OCPL are totally contraindicated. Relative contraindications, again a big risk, big list. Migraine with aura, diabetes or gestational diabetes, hypertension, smoking, uterine leiomyoma, seizure disorder, obstructive jaundice in pregnancy, and hepatic diseases. We will never prescribe OCPL. So let's wait over here for we finish OCPL here, and we will go for implants in next session.